minutes of the previous meeting of August the 18th, 1992. Does anybody have any comments?
No.
I guess before I ask for those comments, I should say that I'd like to correct Mr. McKay to Ms. McKay on page 1 under Stonegate Phase 4. And that's the extent of my corrections.
I move that the minutes are accepted with that amendment.
Second.
All in favor? Voting for the adoption of the minutes?
So, appointed.
Fine. Oh, I'm sorry. I beg your pardon. Beg your pardon. In the absence of two people, I would appoint Judy Lardner to the planning board for this evening's meeting. I also wish to note that in the time from the last meeting, the board has received a notice of a water quality workshop to be held on Thursday, October the 8th, 1992, has received a letter from Robert Crawford, dated September the 9th, 1992, with respect to the John Breja matter on the agenda this evening, has also received, I guess there's nothing else here that needs to be. And a letter dated September the 8th, 1992, from Marilyn Connor, also concerning Mr. Bredge's request for a public access waiver. The first order of business this evening, after the notice of correspondence, is Stonegate Phase 4. Do we have anybody from the applicant here?
Yes, you do.
Glad to see you.
Madam Chair, as I have in the past, I have excused myself from that.
Thank you, Mr. Parkhurst. I would also note for the record that I have in the past excused myself from the consideration of this matter, and I believe that because we still have three voting members, unless the board has some other suggestion, I might chair the meeting, but simply refuse to or abstain from voting on the matter.
I have no problem with that, as long as that's appropriate protocol.
Or if anybody else has any other suggestions, I'd be happy to entertain those as well.
I'd ask our planner if that's number one. Three requires, I believe, three voters. If we were down to three, that would require
a unanimous
vote.
For any motion to carry, it would require a unanimous vote.
Yeah, okay. If the chair abstains from voting, is that acceptable procedure?
It has been the practice of the board that when someone refrains from participating in an item, that they do not participate in any way at all, and that if a chair would have to step down, that someone would be placed, active chair in their place.
I'd be pleased to step down for this matter if anyone else would like to chair the meeting. Mr. Edsel?
I'll chair.
Thank you. That'd
if
be
you
fine.
Think that's
I would be very delighted to have you do that.
Now that we've got that very confusing piece of it, that confusing issue out of the way, I guess we'll proceed. I'd like to have the applicant perhaps very briefly bring us up to speed and date as to any changes, any final descriptions, additions, subtractions to the last time you were here with us.
Chair, members of the board, just as a synopsis quickly, the last time we met was July, I believe, and we say we skipped the August meeting in lieu of trying to tie up our financing and bonding package. And since the July meeting, the several outstanding or conditional issues that were on the table were, one, the showing financial capacity as well as securing a bond for the project, and two, there were a few minor issues, questions raised about the entrance design out on Stonegate, the southerly entrance. And since that time, we haven't made a formal submission as such, but I have discussed with the town planner, with Maureen, and some of these issues to make sure that, as I understand, everything is taken care of at this point. Where we are tonight, and I'll just give briefly go through the plan, a couple plan issues in response to the tonight's planning board memo from Maureen. The financing is the key issue here. CMS has been pursuing a bond for the project, and in terms of financing the project, and at this point they have not yet secured a bond, but are in a position tonight to ask for conditional approval. There are some, the reason being is there are some logistical issues that Bruce Mann from CMS here tonight can probably better answer those questions than I can. But they are, in terms of financial capacity, I believe that we have in the past presented enough for the board to make that conditional approval, and for the actual financial capacity. Bonding would be, we hope, wrapped up in the very near future when some of the details are worked out. Any questions regarding financing and bonding, I suggest you direct to Mr. Bruce Mann here on my side. The second issue that, actually it's a little bit of a disturbing issue, was reading the board memo of tonight, dated September 8th, and in particular the T.Y. Lynn comments. And regarding the entrance design, there must have been some confusion, or maybe just some confusion on my part, but as you remember, we had agreed to do an entrance design and submitted a plan of the landscaping improvements at the southerly entrance onto off of Mitchell Road into the project. And in doing so, what we took a hard look at was, first of all, the magnitude of what we're trying to do here. And what we're trying to do is essentially, going back to the earlier conversations with the board and with the association, is to meet the association's desire to beautify the southerly entrance much in the way the northerly entrance has been, in the same sort of character and formality. Right now, the entrance, as we all know, is somewhat bleak compared to the northerly entrance. CMS took it upon themselves to do this, is to satisfy and be good neighbors to the Homeowners Association, and we've wrapped this whole thing into our final planning board approval. And before you herewith is the plan of the entrance design. In doing the design, what we found was, let me point out what exists now, is the Mitchell Road going north-south and the existing pavement line somewhere through here. We found that by trying to get rid of the raised bermed island in the center here, if you try and eliminate that and dress it up a little bit, our landscape architect took a look at trying to put some signage and some plantings around on either side of the entry, and to dress this up a little bit, put in some paved cobbles in that area so it's actually, it's flush, it's a driving surface if need be, such as the central island of Commercial Street is now. It's concrete, it's a no-drive zone, but it is flush, and it can become part of the travel way to avoid traffic and whatnot. Anyway, in doing so, we felt the need to widen the entrance here, not to create a headache for anybody, but simply to create a safer entrance for the bus and larger vehicles turning into the subdivision. It was our understanding through some conversations with some members in the town that the school buses entered into the project going northbound on Mitchell Road, and hence the wider turning radius on the right, not so much going into the project, not so much on the egress side of the project. And though that additional turning radius was discussed in detail here in Mr. Morin's letter from T.Y. Lynn dated September 8th. And just for the record, I thought I needed to make a stand or just clarify that our understanding was to simply beautify and dress up the entrance. In doing so, we did pull back the pavement and create a little bit wider turning area here. It's been my discussion since then with Maureen that maybe that's not the intent of what the board wanted, that we could keep the pavement the way it is, which is fine by us. We did this out of a need to meet ash tow, school bus, and larger vehicle turning requirements into the subdivision. But what I've seen, and I hope to get some direction from the board on this tonight, is out of reading Mr. Morin's letter, is that we've turned this thing into a real, it's kind of snowballing into from a formalizing and dressing up the entrance into a complete survey and design project within itself. And that wasn't our intent all along. And I just wanted to state that for the record, that we thought we were doing good and well and on a good faith effort providing something for the entrance. And we'd be happy to, again, to reduce this radius and leave it the way it is and simply move the landscaping up, as you see on this side of the road. We'd be happy to do that and correct that. But there's some comments, as you read further on page 2 of Mr. Morin's letter, that basically says this should be an entirely detailed, drawn-out, planning board, town engineer-type reviewed project, and we didn't expect it to get to that level. We feel this plan is sufficient to build the project by, to create a very, very enhancing and well-decorated entrance as it stands by itself with a modification to the radius if the board would so desire.
Okay, thank you, Rick. I guess we'll proceed with any comments from the numerous members of the board. Judith?
I'll just start on that one issue. Maureen, have you talked to school department, public works, or the fire department to see if they have any problems with the existing configuration?
I haven't spoken to anyone in the school department. They're pretty busy this week and last week. But the public works department and the fire chief all get these plans as a matter of course whenever they're submitted, and no one has made any comments to me one way or the other. I mean, in the time that I've been working on this particular review, there's never been any comments from either one of those department heads about the entrance being insufficient.
As one board member, I had no intention of seeing the pavement widened. I like the landscaping, unless someone convinces me that pulling that landscaping closer to the existing road would create some sort of safety hazard because of sight distance. I don't see the need to widen that.
So on that one issue, Tom, do you have any comment?
No, I would agree with Judy. I think the only other thing that if the turning radius is a future issue to deal with, perhaps the best thing to do is to leave the landscaping and the improvements on the right-hand side as you've designed them, and keep the pavement where it is. And in the future, if there's a need to widen that radius, then you could do so without major disruptions of the landscaping.
Yeah, I guess I certainly would concur. I looked at this, and I guess the combination of widening the pavement and extending the radii, in essence, it's more than just a 44-foot opening at the right of way. It really, if you go to edge of pavement and put a scale rule on there, it's a 100-foot opening. And on Mitchell Road for Stonegate Road, it would look very odd. School buses turning into almost all streets off from Mitchell Road and other roads in the town do cross over into another lane. I don't know that it's ever been a problem. I think the reduction of the center island to a flush cobble is a good idea. I live on Mitchell Road, not far from there, and I've seen numerous large trucks, or I should say a number of large trucks, don't slow down for that raised center section anyway. They proceed over it. And I think it gives the turning for a school bus for that location plenty of room with the 28-foot right-of-way. Judy, any other issues?
I guess perhaps just another question to Maureen. Given that there is no more information on the bond that the applicant's been trying to obtain, if we decided to go ahead and approve this tonight, is that asking too much of staff?
I would recommend that if it were approved tonight, that it be with the condition that's proposed on page 2, that a performance guarantee would have to be submitted, and it would have to be done in a form and amount acceptable to the town manager and the town attorney. I don't think that's asking too much of staff. We have a form letter of credit. We have a form escrow account. It's the same kind of issues that we look at for each subdivision. It appears that the applicant has already submitted an amount that's been reviewed by the town engineer, so we're very close. That's usually the most contentious item is just getting that amount approved. So it's not too much to defer to staff. The one thing I would like to point out to the board is that without a performance guarantee, an applicant still can record the subdivision. And it then becomes a subdivision on the face of the earth. No construction can begin until the performance guarantee is posted.
But we could certainly indicate a condition of approval, perhaps, that we do not sign a plat until the performance guarantee be submitted, or if that's what we felt.
And you should note that the ordinance does require, the subdivision ordinance requires that a plat must be recorded within 90 days of its approval, otherwise it's null and void.
Do you think, the applicants, that this performance guarantee could be submitted within 1 or 2 months, or the months mm-hmm. that's proposed? Have we now received evidence of financial capability that is close to what we've received in other cases?
I think that's a determination for the board to make. The most recent submission by the applicant includes an application for bonding and a letter from Clark Associates stating that the applicant has the financial capability to complete the project. So financial capability has never been something that the board has had a standard form or standard piece of information that has to be submitted. It's been a variety based on the applicant.
Okay. I don't have any other comments.
On that same issue, Tom, any comments?
No comments.
Any comments? I don't know if the other board members had a chance to read the note from T.Y. Lynn, which I've already misplaced, as far as comments on the cost. Was that the cost estimate for this? No, that was a different subdivision, sorry.
Right.
Getting ahead of myself. Any other issues at all? Tom or Judy?
No.
Okay. I guess the key issues, again, down through the list are performance guarantee, which it seems to have some concurrence, I think, from the board that we're looking toward something on the order of the proposed motion as a condition. Landscaping, it seemed to be the consensus that the board would move away from the widening of the open. I think it reflected that the landscaping itself, and Judy, correct me, you didn't make mention of it, but the landscaping plan itself seemed to be quite sufficient and
yes.
acceptable. It's just simply the widening of the pavement wasn't with any of the board members. Well, there was no discussion on the Greenbelt Trail itself. We have talked about that time and time again. Any comment from the board? Okay. Hearing no further comment, do I hear a motion from the board? Or any further action? Give me just a second to scratch away. Rick?
Do I have a chance to make a comment? Before
sure, go ahead.
The motion? I guess on that issue, I failed to mention that in my discussion, that there was a question, I'm glad you did scratch my memory on that. That issue was discussed at the last meeting about adding language to the note. There's a note on the recording plat that discusses that the developer will mark the trails as shown on the plan, and I would request that in terms of answering the comment here about constructing, that the intent, of course, is to construct the trails, that we would add a note to the recording plat that says construct and mark, so that there is no uncertainty about that.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Emery.
May I make a motion?
Certainly.
I guess I'll read all the findings of facts. 1, CMS Construction is requesting final subdivision approval of Stonegate Phase 4, a 17-lot subdivision located off Stonegate Road, which requires review under Section 16-2-4C of the subdivision ordinance. The applicant has submitted deeds for land and easements to be donated to the town, which are needed in compliance with Section 16-3-1, CJOQNV. 3, an executed performance guarantee is needed to assure construction of the subdivision according to the approved plans and in compliance with Section 16-2-4C7A. 4, the construction of a green belt trail referenced on the plans is necessary for compliance with 16-3-1J. And five, the final subdivision plan substantially complies with the requirements of the subdivision ordinance. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the applicant of CMS Construction for final subdivision approval of Stone Gate Phase 4, a 17-lot subdivision located off Stone Gate Road, be approved subject to the following conditions. One, that the four land parcels and easements deeds be executed and submitted in a form acceptable to the town attorney. Two, that a performance guarantee be submitted in a form and amount acceptable to the town manager and town attorney by November 1992 meeting of the planning board. Three, that the note on the subdivision plans be revised to specify that the developer shall be responsible for the construction as well as marking of the pedestrian trails. And four, that the south entry landscape plan be revised to indicate the road in its original or existing width.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and second. Is there any further discussion?
Tom or Steve, do you think it's necessary to indicate on condition three that the subdivision plat will not be recorded until the acceptable performance guarantee is submitted?
If that's indeed the case, I think that would be very helpful to make that a very clear issue.
Is that a particular problem for the applicant? I would suggest we add that. Is it necessary to indicate in your condition four that the proposed landscaping and cobblestone island will be constructed as shown? To clarify that, or do you?
Well, why don't we say so, if that's...
Okay, I take it the cobble, flush cobble is in the same, that would not change the, right?
No, same,
that's in the same
general
location.
It would just be, rather than a raised, it would be a flush cobble type.
So the Fourth Amendment would read that the plan be revised, I can't even read my own writing, basically that the landscaping and cobble, Maureen, you want to help me there?
Well, what I have on number four is that the south entry landscaping plan be revised to show the road in its existing location and width, which means that the cobble that's already shown on the plan would still be on there and the landscaping would still be there.
Is that acceptable to the board members?
Because there is cobble on there is existing, isn't there?
No.
No,
it's
no.
A raised curb,
it's a raised
bermed.
Asphalt berm.
And how would the area that's proposed to be paved now be treated if it's not paved? Would it be grassed or... mulch.
I'd recommend we go back and take a look at it. We could move the landscaping up a little bit and still maintain some sight line here, and probably loam between seeding, mulching, work it out to the landscape designer in the office. But
Maureen, would you want to review those plans?
Oh, yes. Perhaps there should be an amendment then that four would read that the south entry landscaping plan be revised to show the road to existing location and width, and that the center area include a flushed cobbled lane divider. Is that basically what the board wants?
That include every...
Is that the existing island? I mean, what we're talking about is the existing island will be removed and in its place
right.
The cobbles.
Right. Yeah. It's in the same location.
Yeah.
It simply will be...
Okay.
And do we need...
Curb will be removed and replaced with a flush mm-hmm. cobbled
right,
surface.
Right.
And do we need to state that it be submitted to the town planner for review or something of that nature? We often do that.
I think we should, since Maureen would like to review that. Okay, could we have number three, was it the consensus of the board to add to number three? No, did you want to add the not recording the plat until the performance guarantee was acceptable to number two?
Oh, or excuse me, two, yes.
Okay.
I said the wrong number.
All right. Maureen, could you reread number two and four for us, please?
Okay. Number two, that a performance guarantee be submitted in form and amount acceptable to the town manager and town attorney by the November 1992 meeting of the planning board and prior to recording of the subdivision plat. And then number four, south entry landscaping plan be revised to show the road to show the road in its existing location and width, and that the center area include a flush cobbled lane divider. The plan shall be submitted to the town planner for review.
Is that acceptable to the mover, the motioner, and the seconder?
I would say to the co-movers.
Co-movers and shakers. Is there any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as made and amended, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. 3-0. Return the chair to Ms. McKay.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much.
It's a long process. Thank you.
The next item of business is Rams Head Subdivision, a request by Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision review, a wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers of Rams Head, a four-lot subdivision located south of Ram Island Farm. The plan was deemed complete in May. A public hearing has been held, and I think we're now simply discussing the open issues which remain. For the record, I'd like to advise those people listening at home that I think we have, at least to my mind, two open issues and perhaps more. One is the open space fee issue, and the applicant's attorney has contended that this subdivision does not create a deficiency and that the fee might be unconstitutional. The town attorney has recommended that the fee is constitutional, and the council has already made a determination that a deficiency is created. So that's, I think, the first order of business to attack tonight, and I welcome comments from the board, or perhaps the applicant would like to make something to start with.
My name is Rick Cheney, and I'm an attorney for Shaw Sprague. I think, I'm assuming, first of all, that the pedestrian access easement issue has been resolved to the board's satisfaction, at least to council's satisfaction, to staff's satisfaction. It doesn't appear on as an open issue on Maureen's memo, so we'll just leave that where it is. I think you're right about the two issues. Issue number one is the open space fee, and I you've seen my letter, and at the risk of reading it into the record, I want to say that I'm not, Mike Hill's opinion doesn't address what I consider to be a fundamental problem with your fee schedule, which is simply doesn't meet state law requirements for the adoption of impact fees. As I understand it, the fee schedule, first of all, you can't find it in the ordinance, you got to hunt around till you get it. When you get it, it says 10%. Mike Hill says that the opinion that the fee is up to 10%, consistent with the concept of open space deficiency. Either you set aside up to 10% or you pay a fee up to 10%. No one has categorically said to me the fee is 10% of the assessed value of this project, but in bits and pieces, I guess that's what I'm being told by the town, that either we give some open space or we pay a fee of 10% of the assessed value, which would amount to a fee in excess of $100,000. I've got real problems with that because, first of all, there has still not been a determination by this board as to what the deficiency is that the project creates. And I think Mr. Hill even says in his opinion he would recommend that the board make a finding of fact as to what the deficiency is. We don't think there is a deficiency. To the extent there is, the project deals with it in the way it's laid out, the maintenance of open space, visual access to the ocean, et cetera. If there's a deficiency, it's minimal at best, and we don't think that that deficiency rises to the level of a payment of a fee in excess of $100,000. The problems I have with the impact fee as they relate to state law is, first and foremost, as I understand the timetable here, the impact fee schedule was adopted before Maine's impact fee statute, and prior to that time, my understanding is that municipalities did not have the authority to adopt impact fees. But assuming that it was properly adopted, it simply doesn't meet the requirements of state law under 30A MRSA 4354. And most importantly, it's not reasonably related to any kind of impact that this subdivision presumably makes on the community. My understanding of the town council's position on the impact is that it is something to do with new homes, more people, impact on recreational facilities. But applied to this project and coupled with the fee, it's not rational. There's no direct relationship between the impact fee and whatever the deficiency is. If we had 10 lots rather than 4 or 2, actually, if there's only 2 new homes, according to your fee schedule, we would still pay up to 10% of the assessed value, as opposed to any kind of consideration as to how many new homes generate how many people using what recreational facilities in the town. So we really have some problems with the impact fee as it relates to state law. And again, it's outlined and set forth, I think, in my letter, which I hope you've all had a chance to read. So we're asking the board to if you're going to imply a fee, we'd like you to determine what the deficiency is. We think a fee in excess of $100,000 is just not supported by your ordinance or by state law. The other issue is the dead-end street issue. My understanding of the town council's position is that the dead-end condition has to include the measurement of the existing public road. That being the case, then my assumption is that any property that fronts on any long public dead-end road in this town is no longer subdividable, absent a second means of access. We think that's a poor result for the ordinance to achieve, but if that's the position of the town, so be it. We've pointed out that there is a second means of access to the property across an existing private road that makes its way through the Spray Corporation property into this subdivision and also services other homes. There may be other roads that aren't as passable now, but Shaw Spray may be willing to improve those roads so as to minimize the impact of having potential emergency access going across a private road. The point is there is an alternate means of access, which we think the town could use in an emergency situation. I understand your position is that its mere existence isn't sufficient. There has to be some sort of legal rights. And I guess tonight we would hope that the board would give us some direction as to the extent of rights that it would like to see. And I noticed that you apparently have dealt with a similar issue on the Highlands project. And it might be helpful to us to see what ultimate agreement was acceptable to the board in that situation. We have researched, I pointed out in my letter of the 28th that we believe we have rights to that road, or at least there's an argument that we have rights to that road under our deed. We spent an extensive amount of time researching that, and we can't come up with an answer one way or the other. It's not entirely clear. So at this point, I can't say for sure that we have deeded rights to it. Depending on the extent of the rights that the board thinks we should have in order to make that an acceptable alternate means of access, then we may be willing to go back to the corporation and try to negotiate some further agreement along those lines. What we would probably like to present would be an easement agreement from the corporation to Shaw Sprague that would essentially convey as a pertinent to the project emergency access over that road. And that sort of a concept I would not want to get into, if we could avoid it, having the corporation have to grant something to the town. I think if it were granted to Shaw as a pertinent to the project, those rights would naturally flow to the town under emergency purposes to reach the project. So those are the two. We hope the pedestrian easement issue is solved. We continue to have problems with the entire open space impact fee, and my letter sets forth our position a lot better than I can say tonight. And on the dead-end road issue, we're concerned about the impact of the ordinance, but if we can get some direction from the board as to what exactly you'd like to see by way of legal rights to that road and to who those would flow, then we would be willing to go back to the corporation and see if something can be done along those lines to satisfy that problem. And I'll answer any questions. Obviously.
Thank you, Mr. Cheney. Perhaps the first question would be to our town planner. Are we, is the public access issue resolved to the satisfaction of the town planner?
The town attorney has recommended that that is a standard that can be recommended by the board, but not necessarily required. I guess I'd just like to point out that there are applicants in the past that have used pedestrian easements to meet their open space requirement. So I don't see it as saying, okay, we can cross that off the list and we don't have to deal with it anymore. There's still an option there for the applicant to consider that in meeting your open space requirement, which both the town attorney and myself and everyone else we've talked to still believes is a valid requirement, in lieu of paying an open space fee, you might be able to offer some kind of pedestrian easement that the town would find acceptable and meet that standard. I guess the other thing I would like to point out is that the open space fee is not set up as an impact fee. It's set up as a fee in lieu of donating open space.
You can call it what you want, but I think it's an impact fee, and you know, I've got to disagree with that. You can't just have an arbitrary fee like that without meeting, you know, some minimal requirements under state law for permitting a community to take a fee in lieu of some, I mean, under these. As I understand it, that the idea is that this is going to cause subdivisions, cause the town to presumably have to acquire or improve existing facilities. And that's what the impact fee is all about. And if you're going to do that, it's got to be reasonably related to what the impact requires the town to do. And you know, we're going to disagree on what you want to call your fee. Mike Hill has referred to it as an impact fee in his opinion letter. But beyond that, he hasn't addressed any of the arguments that I set forth in my letter of the 12th, the 28th, or 12th, actually.
Did you have anything further you wanted to say? Any comments from board members?
Madam Chair.
Mr. Edsel.
I guess number one on the open space issue, I left the last meeting thinking that the applicant would go to the town council. If it would be my opinion that if the applicant, number one, wishes not to take the route of providing up to 10% of the subdivision's total land area as open space and does not think that the fee set forth in the ordinance is fair, then you would approach the town council and make your argument. It may be a very sound and logical argument, and but that, I think, in at least my opinion, comes from them, not from us. If it is other than what is going to be stated here in the ordinance, then I think you need to approach the town council. The issue of...
Can I just...
Sure.
I'm a little confused. I think at the last meeting we talked about having to go to the council to perhaps seek a waiver of the dead-end road issue because this board's not permitted to waive it. We've since been advised by Maureen that can't be done. We would be seeking a text change to do that. I don't think we were looking to go to the council on the impact fee.
At the last meeting, the applicant said that they weren't interested in donating open space and
correct.
They weren't interested in paying any fee. And I guess that I assumed that the applicant would reconsider that and say, well, the only, according to the ordinance, looks like our approach to this is to go to the town council. I'm sorry, I assumed that. And you're right, we didn't, and we had not given you that direction. I assumed that you would proceed to the town council.
Well, your town attorney has interpreted the ordinance and the schedule differently from the way this board is interpreting it. Mr. Hill has said in his letter of the 8th that reading the ordinance together with, he says, when 16.3.1Q and the fee schedule adopted by the council are read together, we interpret the fee schedule to impose a fee of up to 10% of the current assessed value of the land. I'm just going on what your attorney
Then I would simply think that the applicant would say we feel that 5% of the assessed value is fair, and that is in lieu of donating open space, or providing open space, this is what the applicant intends to do. I'm not sure that that requires town council approval, but I'll turn to our town planner on that issue.
Well, again, you're saying that the fee schedule is 10%. Your own attorney is saying it is up to 10%, and he is prefacing all of that on a determination of what the deficiency is that the project creates. He has said that in his opinion, that this office would recommend the board quantify the potential deficiency. And that is what I said two meetings ago, that the ordinance on its face is prefaced on there being a deficiency created by the subdivision.
And our town council says that, or our legal counsel states that,
yes.
Town council has legislatively stated that all subdivisions create a deficiency.
Well, Mike, I mean, I just think that's...
I guess you disagree.
Obviously, I disagree that a carte blanche statement that all subdivisions create a deficiency...
Do you read that any differently than I do? That's what
I read the ordinance as saying, if there's a deficiency created by the subdivision, which the planning board determines, then up to 10% of the land must be set aside for open space to serve that subdivision, or you pay a fee, and unfortunately your fee schedule says 10%. It's confusing. It's not in the ordinance. No one has ever paid it before, so no one has ever asked what it is. But now we have an interpretation from your lawyer, stop using counsel to get confused between the two, that it's either up to 10% of the land mass or up to 10% in fee based upon a determination as to what the deficiency is. That's all I'm saying. If you apply the literal interpretation of your fee schedule, Shaw Sprague has to pay the town well over $100,000 for two houses.
Or based on the assessed value, which
right,
I assume that you're...
If he was putting 10...
It's a four-lot subdivision. Regardless of how many houses are there, it's still a four-lot subdivision. It's based on the assessed value of the entire land. And that's simply straight from the ordinance.
That's the fee schedule.
Right.
But the concept of the deficient, maybe I'm wrong in my understanding of what the deficiency is, but I've been told, pieced together, that the deficiency that the council, the group that sits here, is talking about is an impact. People use recreational facilities. If you're going to build a subdivision in Cape Elizabeth, you're going to have more people come to town, you have an impact, you ought to set aside some space within the subdivision to offset.
I think it's
like a no-net loss recreational
facility. I think that's legitimate in that we're looking at a four-lot subdivision that has a half a mile of ocean frontage.
What is the impact of ocean frontage on recreational facilities?
Indicate,
if anything,
I'm
it's
simply
it's
going
a
from
loss.
Our legal counsel's opinion that has already been, the deficiency has been established by the town council. In that all subdivisions in Cape Elizabeth create a deficiency. I think you need to proceed to the town council if you disagree with that. It seems to be the issue. You simply don't like that part of our ordinance. And number one, the applicant does not want to provide any open space. Number two, does not want to pay a fee in lieu of providing that space.
We certainly don't want to pay a fee of excess $100,000.
At the first of my comments, I said that I think, or I made the incorrect assumption that the applicant would proceed to the town council and say, we don't think $100,000 is fair. We think $10 is fair. But you make that appeal to the town council.
If we get through the dead end road issue. And that's the other big issue.
Yeah, let's go to that.
I guess I would prefer that the board either condition approval based on that requirement or turn us down based on that requirement, and then we'll deal with it in an appropriate manner.
As far as the dead-end issue, dead-end road issue, I would like to see that as a solution to this problem the planning board has been giving very clear direction that we don't waive that requirement of the ordinance.
That
the applicant has found what may be a legitimate and workable second access to this subdivision. I would, as one board member, look to the applicant to just indicate, number one, the legal use of the road, and number two, provide us some substantiation for the physical capability of the road to handle emergency vehicles.
Am I wrong that the fire chief and the town manager have found the physical existence of the road more or less acceptable?
That's incorrect.
Okay. That's, your memo suggests otherwise, but...
What the memo states is that the town manager and the fire chief have gone over the road, and they think that with certain assurances that the town has legal rights and maintenance responsibilities that are going to be picked up by the applicant, that it can be a road that will serve as a secondary means of access. And I think my memo tries to state that the concerns they have is, one, that there be some legal right of the town to use that road without it being blocked off. Two, that it be maintained. There are portions of the road that are very narrow. It needs to be regraded, and there's some ponding in areas. And three, that there be a guarantee that it's going to be plowed in the winter, so it's going to be a through road year-round. Those were the three basic issues that were the concern. With the Highland subdivision, the town actually took a much stronger position, where they said there must be a public right-of-way. And that is not the recommendations being made by the town manager and the fire chief at this time.
Is the Highlands right-of-way simply an easement across somebody else's land, or
it's
part of the
property? No, it's a right-of-way that's been deeded to the town.
But it's part of the fee, the property.
It's owned by the town.
But it was, before it was owned by the town,
yes,
it was part of the land mass that the developer owned.
Correct.
As opposed to this situation, where what we can logically get would be an appurtenant easement from the corporation to Shaw Sprague. I mean, legally, we couldn't have the corporation grant the easement to the town, because it wouldn't, I don't want to bore you, but you know what I'm talking about.
I think there are plenty of other examples, and I was trying to think of one. Wildwood condominium is mm-hmm. before my time, but I think perhaps that second access is not on the condominium association common land, but that has also been an issue of dissatisfaction by the police chief in public works, is that tends to be blocked. It's not always plowed. There's some, there are vehicles in the way and so forth. Those are the types of issues that need to be clarified. I think I took the comments in the notes to mean that this looks like it may be a workable second access road, and perhaps it wasn't clear enough to the applicant that these are the things we're looking for that need to be clarified enough to make it acceptable, and we can start measuring from that point.
If we work up an acceptable grant or an agreement between the corporation and Shaw Sprague that would run with the land, would be appurtenant to the subdivision, and assuming that grant had conditions in it that were satisfied your concerns, we have the right to maintain it, keep it open, passable, etc. Is that what the board would consider to be the right approach, or is the board saying we want something, an agreement between the corporation and the town? I mean, we could structure an easement that would be a grant of an emergency access easement over the road from the corporation, which owns the fee title to the land, to Shaw Sprague as appurtenant to the subdivision for the purposes of providing emergency access by public and private emergency vehicles and that sort of thing. And then that easement would be part of what he owns and would run with the land. The town wouldn't necessarily have to be a party to that agreement, although perhaps we could build into it that if the applicant failed to meet its obligations, the town would have the right to come in and do what it has to do. I have some problems going to the corporation and saying the town of Cape Elizabeth wants the corporation to give the town some kind of an access easement across the road, but we might be able to work something out with the corporation that would be essentially a grant from the corporation to Shaw to benefit the subdivision. You understand the distinction I'm trying to make?
I think Ms. Lardner does. I can only answer as one board member, Mr. Cheney, but I, as far as I'm concerned, if you could craft an easement which was to Mr. Sprague to run a pertinent to the subdivision and would have third-party enforcement rights in the event the applicant didn't maintain its obligations. I certainly would be satisfied with that. Ms. Gardner, would that be satisfactory to you?
Yes, and I was going to even say if the corporation had some problems with it year-round, the Highlands is gated. And I don't know exactly what the language says on that one particular stretch of the road, but I assume the town has a key and can open it. I would even feel comfortable with that, given that it goes over private property, as long as there's no problem for emergency access.
The road, I don't know if you've driven it, but most of the road is in pretty good shape. I mean, it's a good road that serves other homes on the project, most notably Bob Monk's home. As you get down within, say, 300 to 400 yards of this subdivision, it veers off to the right, and then that stretch is pretty rough. I mean, Maureen and I drove it with my Honda, but I think I left my muffler behind somewhere. that obviously would need some work. But the main portion that starts in at the nursery is a private driveway, and it's in good shape. It's maintained. And now, what we may want to do is there is another stretch that veers off of that road further back towards 77. And would come around, it would get to the subdivision, but through a different route. That road is not used very often. And either one of those may be acceptable to the corporation in terms of a grant. So the road that you and I drove may not the stretch out of the subdivision into what I refer to as the Monk's Road, for lack of a better name, may not be the stretch we're talking about. We may go up another route, but we would obviously make it passable. Well, that's helpful to me.
Are there any other comments from board members on the on either issue?
I just want to be clear. The term open space is used quite a bit, and I'm sorry, I don't have my plan in front of me this evening, but I recall that there's considerable open space as a result of the subdivision, that there are some wetland areas. I think the issue here is open space that has public easements or access. And is that's not the issue. Is there not 10% open space as part of this project?
In the past, applicants have used a variety of ways to meet the subdivision standard. They've used pedestrian easements, they've used donations of land to the town, they've also used conservation easements. So there really isn't a set way of meeting it. The problem is that the burden is always on the applicant to show that they've met that standard, and then the board usually makes the determination whether the deficiency has been met, and that hasn't been possible in this case. Just to go over, I don't believe that standard. Let's see. The planning board shall require the subdivider to provide an area suitable for recreation or open space.
Why don't you read the entire...
Keep reading.
It does not require an area suitable for recreation or open space up to 10% of the subdivision's total land area or pay a fee established by the council. Open space fee would have to be used primarily for use of owners of lots within the subdivision in order to address a recreational open space deficiency to be created by the proposed subdivision. Land reserved for active recreational purposes, such as a playground or ball field, shall be relatively dry. Land reserved for primary scenic or passive recreation purposes shall have sufficient public access as determined by the planning board.
Does that public access mean public access for members of the subdivision, or generally public access that enhances the community's green belt?
Yeah, usually when public access is discussed, it means the general public. However, right now there hasn't been any presentation by the applicant of any kind of an open space package to even review.
Let me just go back to the applicant. In terms of the subdivision itself there are four lots, and then there's a large area that's reserved, I guess, with Shaw Sprague's lot. Do you happen to have a plan of that?
I'm sorry I didn't bring it, but you're right. There are four lots. The first two would be where lot one would be undeveloped. That would be a raw lot land. That's as you come in. Lot two has the Pierce Cottage on it, the existing home. Lot three is the main house. And lot four is undeveloped and includes virtually the entire wetlands and open space area down in the beach, most of the beach. So you'd be building on 1 and 4, if ever. 2 perhaps, 3 perhaps. There are building windows, but obviously there's already existing houses on
there. And there's nothing in the application that restricts future subdivision of the remaining land?
Well, we would obviously have to come back to you for amended subdivision approval, so...
All the land along the beach shall remain in the financial state period. And, I mean, we've said it since day one. I mean,
Mr. Hare, would you identify yourself for the record, please?
My name's Brad Hare, and I'm a land planner for Shaw Spray. You know, since day one, we've maintained that 26 out of the 36 acres are going to be protected in its natural state. They're either wetlands or sand dunes or frontal dunes or back dunes. You know, we clearly state on the plan and the recording plat that that land is to remain in its natural state forever. We even revised it according to the town's wishes in the town's language to make it even more stringent. We've never had any intention of further subdividing it. We've said it, you know, many times. And we've also argue the fact, not successfully so far, that open space is there for the use of the subdividers. And our intention is that, you know, why would you impact some other place when you have an 8-acre beach that's going to be maintained, and you have open space front of your house, back of your house, all around your house. And that open space that's intrinsic to the site, being almost 80% of the entire lot, should, in all common sense, somehow offset the deficit that someone thinks we're going to create here by creating a four-lot subdivision.
Well, excuse me. Well, it would seem to me that the real issue is that we're talking about the issue of public access, public open space, and the terms public meaning something beyond the subdivision, which is typically what has happened, at least in my brief experience on the board with other subdivisions, that the public access easements go to the town, not just to members of the subdivision. I don't have an opinion one way. I'm very torn by this issue. I'm torn by the history of the family's contribution to the community, the amount of open space that's there now, and I don't take past good deeds lightly. I have a lot of respect for what the family's already done for the town. On the other hand, if Shar as an applicant has to meet the same criteria that other people have to meet under the ordinance, I just want to be very clear that we're talking what it is that we're talking about when we talk about open space, and whether we're indeed talking about just open space or whether we're talking about public access to that open space or whether we're talking about an access easement or whether we're talking about a conservation easement that would either go to protect the land within the subdivision or would be held in some other control that would be either through the town or other mechanisms.
Well, I can tell you what I'm talking about. Item J of your subdivision regulations talks about pedestrian easements, which we understand to mean could mean, for example, a grant of a pathway across the subdivided property to the town for the benefit of the public, plain and simple. Now, we don't think you can do that, and we've said why we don't think you can do that, and we think Mike Hill agrees with us. So now we're left with provision Q. My problem with provision Q, putting aside the basic issue of it, I read it as requiring you address a problem if the problem exists. You'd address the deficiency if it exists. The trouble with Q is that the pedestrian access easement issue sneaks back in because it talks about recreation and open space land primarily for the use of owners of lots in the subdivision. The word primarily implies others may get the right to use it, i.e. public access easements, and you're right back to provision J, which we have a serious constitutional problem with. But then the last sentence of provision Q says, land reserved for primary scenic or passive recreation purposes, which we think we've done by leaving this beach, you know, every whole lot is on the ocean, shall have sufficient public access. Again, the public access issue, which we have problems with under the Nolan decision, sneaks back in under the open space provision. I say the open space provision makes logical sense to me if what you're saying is you create a 20 or 30 lot subdivision and you don't provide any common space within that subdivision for the people who live there to use for passive and active recreation, then you're potentially creating some sort of a deficiency that the town is going to have to address. It makes some sense. 20, 30 lots, big subdivision, more people. The town is going to be required to provide more park space, more ball fields, etc. Okay, there's some level of deficiency created by that thing, that size of project. But if the subdivider says, but I am going to put a ball field in my project or a park or something that the lot owners who live there can use, then it offsets the problem and it shouldn't, and to my opinion, the subdivider would have met the requirements of the ordinance. No public access to that space except for the people who live there and their guests. The subdivider says, I don't want to put aside some open space. Okay, subdivider, your alternative is to pay a fee. Your fee schedule says 10%. Your ordinance on the donation of land says up to 10%. Your attorney has said, I think that the fee schedule ought to say, be read to me, up to 10%, just like the ordinance on on creating open space says up to 10%. So what we're saying is, one, there's no deficiency. Two, if there's a deficiency, it is a minimal deficiency, and we have addressed it by creating lots that all have access to the ocean, probably one of the most valuable scenic and passive recreation amenities one could ever have, certainly in the state of Maine. We have addressed the deficiencies, we have internalized those, we have, in a sense, created open space for each lot. To the extent that's not the case in your mind, then we think that some fee less than 10% ought to be proposed based on your finding as to what the deficiency is. But then I have a real problem with your, what I call an impact fee, because it simply doesn't meet the basic requirements under state law for the adoption of an impact fee. One of the primary ones being the fee has to be reasonably related to the impact that the subdivision creates. The classic example is our sewer lines. If you've got to extend a public sewer 5 miles to serve a subdivision, I think under the impact fee statute in Maine, if the, that's only an enabling statute, it doesn't say it exists, you've got to pass it. A town could say, subdivider, you can build your subdivision, but you got to contribute to the infrastructure improvements that we have to do to service that project. This situation, there's no relationship. There's no relationship between what impact we're apparently having on the community and $100-some-odd thousand fee. If we're doing two houses, there'd be no fee. But because we're doing a subdivision, we fall into the regulations, and all of a sudden, Shaw Sprague is being asked to contribute well over $100,000 for an impact that no one has yet quantified. Now, that's our problem, and that's how I interpret it. I am not talking, when I talk about your provision Q in the open space, I'm not talking about public access in the sense that people who don't live there would have a right to go on there.
Thank you, Mr. Cheney. Ms. Lardner?
Something I suggested long ago about trying to treat the pond area as your recreation or open space, I think, was dismissed because you didn't like the notion of creating some ownership group or something. I think you were concerned about that. I think the applicant and the board knows that I have problems with any amount of public access to this. I don't really care what the ordinance says. I think, given the history of the piece, the notion that we would require them to grant some access for people to actually come onto the property and enjoy it, I don't agree with that. I do see, though, that the language says we shall require some open space or we shall require a fee, and I do not know why you have not considered not really changing what you're proposing, but saying, okay, our pond area, which is shared by what, 3 lots or all 4? I know 1 and 2, I think, share it.
Well, it's part of the three.
Why one wouldn't put in your deed, because you've already said that area will not be developed or cannot be developed, specifically delineate on the plan that that area of the pond, even though it remains in 4 separate ownerships, shall not be developed in any way and shall be reserved for scenic enjoyment, and why you do not mark a part of the coastline which you cannot develop anyway, including the vast amount of lot 4, or choose a part of lot 4 and say this area is reserved for scenic enjoyment. You can certainly make an argument that any bit of the public who is out there boating or clamming, I can't remember what the three things are, the rights we have in the state, can, the rights they already have, someone sailing by in the boat has those scenic resources, which are very substantial. I don't understand why you don't at least try that much, and I think that's a compelling argument that you've met those requirements.
Well, I'm not sure that we haven't done that.
I remember when we talked about Lot 4 and the beach area, you said it's restricted by the state and this and that, we can't do anything with it, and we're not willing to grant any other rights in it. Why don't you grant a scenic easement over it?
Whom?
It could be just to the town, or it could be perhaps as much as in your deed, stating it will not be developed because it is reserved for the scenic enjoyment of the public or something. It seems to me you can provide this and still maintain what Shaw wants, and I respect his privacy, and I know it's an extraordinary parcel, and the public should be able to use it in the best of all possible worlds, but we're facing private ownership here. You can't see any way to do this?
Well,
I could see ways of doing that. I mean, I think that
Mr. Hare, would you approach the microphone?
To look into something like that, but from the town to us, it's never been anywhere near that simple. It's been, we want your beach. We want the public to drive down in there.
I don't think
no,
it has to that, be
that's a complete misunderstanding.
Well,
matter of fact,
from day one,
it is not the burden of this board to come forward to you and plainly say, we're looking for compromise. And that has been my intent all along.
Mr. Etzel,
and
with all due respect,
have not
with all due
come
respect,
forward with any
just,
other proposal other than saying, we're not going to do that.
With all due respect, Maureen's initial memo, at which she first reviewed this criteria, said something to the effect that the town manager sees this as an opportunity to acquire access to the beach.
But
something to that effect.
Certainly not a requirement.
Mr. Chenet, I'm not sure it's that important about
what
the town manager
thinks. Well, I think it is in the sense
because
that we're being told. Ms. Lardner has suggested a rather simple solution. I have to think about it, but it is a long way from what the impression that we have received from other individuals in this town as to what we had to do to get over this burden, the most significant being, basically, you don't give us a public access right to that beach, and we're not so sure you're going to get approval. Now, that hasn't been said in that direct a manner, but it has certainly been intimated to me, and until we finally got your attorney to take some kind of a legal position, based after looking at my argument, have we now reached the point where the concept of us giving the public the right to go on this project as a condition for approval, absolutely no different from the Nolan case, have we finally gotten over that hurdle, but we are now talking about open space and still talking about the idea of giving someone other than people who buy lots in the subdivision some kind of access, be it scenic or direct access. I mean, and that's the problem that we have. We think, again, that the subdivision as designed addresses open space problems internally to the lots. That ought to be the end of the discussion. I think this board can find tonight that the deficiency, if it exists at all, has been addressed by the design of the project, period.
I, for one board member, you can see how flexible I am and how that's defined. I'm not convinced that that is the intent at all, and changing some simple language in deeds and on the plan addresses my concern, and I'm not speaking for the board when I'm talking about visual access from the shore. I have not seen, I understand your point, but I have not seen any indication that you're putting forth any real plan for addressing the standard, and I think it's clear we have to meet it, and it's up to 10%, I agree with that. I disagree with our fee schedule, and I don't think it would be upheld in law. That's a personal opinion. But I'd like to see you put forth saying this is what, on the plan, this is our open space. It says it's our open space. It is addressing our 10%. It is for, we've maintained the right for all four lot owners to visually enjoy each other's pond. You don't even have to let them go on the property, but do something that we can say, this is your best attempt.
Happy to comment
any of the board members agree with that?
One person, I guess.
Excuse me, let's continue the discussion, Mr. Parker. Do you have anything to add?
One quick question. Many meetings ago, we had talked about the deed restrictions on Lot 4, and you were unwilling to provide, at least at that time, any further deed restrictions on that lot. It was my one comment, I think, at that meeting, that that lot should be further restricted forever as to one house in the building window that's on that lot, and the rest of it left as open space. Why couldn't that be a solution to this problem?
That when we talked about that, it wasn't presented at that time as addressing the standard we're now talking about. If tonight you're saying to me, if you further restrict development on the wetland area, so as to prevent development on there regardless of what happens under the law, that might be sufficient to address and satisfy provision Q, that's a new twist to me, and I'm happy to go back to Shaw and talk about it. The discussion didn't come up in that context 3 or 4 meetings ago. Well, it was just one of many stacked on issues.
I don't believe it was given a chance to, because you were so adamant about any further deed restrictions on that lot, it wasn't even considered as a possibility. And here we are 5 meetings from that, from then, hoping to come up with this. It should have been something that was presented by you to us as a possible solution.
I appreciate it as a possible solution. I'm just simply saying at the time it was discussed, it was another restriction over and above. It still meant we still had to address the open space fee issue and the public access, and we want some restrictions, more restrictions on Lot 4. I apologize if I didn't take the bait. I got the message now, and we'll go back and talk to Shaw along those lines. But I guess I'd like to have some sense from the board that if he were willing to impose additional restrictions on that area such that every lot owner who buys in there would have a right to enforce those restrictions, and they would essentially say no further development within the the resource protection area. If we came back with that as a proposal, do I get some sense that the board would have addressed provision Q to the majority satisfaction?
Speaking as one board member, that would certainly satisfy me.
Okay.
Ms. Lardner?
Would your intention be that lots 1 through 3 could walk on that beach area or not?
Now you're adding another twist.
No, is that something you would investigate?
No.
Or is that what you were expecting, that the other lots would share?
Well, I would expect that people buying in that subdivision would be friendly enough so they could walk down to the beach.
Shaw has told
big
me
assumptions.
That. No, they're all, Shaw's plan is he wants to sell everything but Lot 4 and ultimately hopes to build a home there. I mean, that's where he wants to end up. He has told me as long as he lives there, he would obviously tell his neighbors, you're welcome to use my beach. However, he's not, doesn't want to make that an appurtenant interest to the other lots, because he may not live there. He may decide to sell the lot, and he's not so sure that the next buyer would be willing to buy that lot if he knew that it was open for access by all the other lot owners. I mean, they all have access to the ocean. It's not like there are inland lots there. Lots 3 and 4 have access to the beach. Lots 1 and 2 have access to the other side, what's more of a rocky beach, but they all have direct access to the ocean. I think, however, that the concept further restricting it in our declaration such that we would agree to keep it open and undeveloped so as to satisfy the recreational needs of people in their boats or others that drive into the subdivision, that's an interesting twist to address the condition. If the board is saying that would get us over the hurdle, I'm willing to go back and say that. You weren't saying that 3 meetings ago. It's another condition. So, but, I don't think he's interested in making the beach generally available as a deeded right to all the lot owners.
But as a practical matter, if they all have access to the shore, they do all have access to the beach below the high water mark, correct?
For certain specific things, not for laying out and lathering themselves with suntan oil and all that sort of stuff.
So everyone has to buy a shotgun.
I understand there's a concession for plastic poles down in Agunkwit now. So. Yes, you're right. Practical purposes, they would have the right to go on between low and high water to fish, fowl, and navigate, whatever that means.
Mr. Emery?
I would just, it sounds a lot like what we're talking about, in essence, is a conservation easement. I know Shaw has a tremendous background in land conservation, and the irony is so heartfelt here, that here we have someone who is so progressive in conservation issues, and yet when it comes down to four lots, the issue was brought up a long time ago about dividing that pond into four pieces like it's nothing more than just another flat piece of earth. The plan's been presented, we've accepted that as that, and that's all I'm going to say. I just think it's unfortunate with such a unique piece of land to be using relatively very simple and archaic approaches to treating the unique attributes of it. One thing that hasn't been, this is a peripheral issue, but one thing that really hasn't been considered here, this is a four-lot subdivision. You repeatedly say that it's only adding two additional lots in terms of its impact. However, the Sprague Corporation owns a terrific amount of property in the town. And the accumulative impact, not to overuse a word that's overused, but the accumulative impact of four-lot subdivisions within that property and the loss of public access at some point to some piece of land, I think, is of paramount importance to the town. It's been expressed in its comprehensive plan. So while we may not have an opportunity here, this may be a unique situation. It's something that the board is extremely sensitive to. And with any future subdivision, I think the board would be looking very closely and perhaps is very much behind, other than exactly what's stated in the ordinance in terms of dead-end roads. If this were the only four-lot subdivision at the end of this road, that issue may have gone away. But it's clear that it perhaps won't be over the next several years. And that's why we're trying to address or at least raise the flag at this point in the process. In terms of what's been discussed, I would support the idea of putting something on the plan that reserves the resource protection areas and allow that to serve as the open space contribution of this project.
That or the pond, something like that.
Mm-hmm. And Mr. Chenet, just speaking as one board member, I also support the ideas expressed in different terms by Ms. Lardner and Mr. Parkhurst and Mr. Emery that we ought to be able to find some way to solve this problem. I do, for my purposes, I understand that the town council has determined that there is a deficiency by definition, but I certainly would express that deficiency in this subdivision as minimal at best. And if you can reasonably satisfy me in a number of different ways with respect to your good faith attempt to comply with Q, I think I would be satisfied.
I appreciate that. The resolution of the public access issue certainly goes a long way to make it possible for us to work something out, I think.
Any other comments from any board members?
Just a quick comment, I think, raised, I can't remember where it is in the memo, about emergency access on this proposed secondary access. I personally, unless the fire chief felt very strongly, I'm not necessarily concerned that the bridge might not contain a ladder truck, since we're probably going to require you to sprinkle. You know, I wouldn't personally be looking for this whole road to be constructed heavy duty, as long as it would be passable to whatever emergency vehicles the town feels necessary. That's all I would be looking for.
Yeah, I think we're going to have a hard time asking the corporation to permit us to improve and expand this road, I think. I obviously don't represent the corporation, but I think given our ability to deal with the corporation on the relocation of the main access road to the project, I think I can go to the corporation and say we have hit a dead end, so to speak, in this project, and what we need is to clarify the extent of the availability of a road that goes across your property to service this project strictly for emergency purposes only and for no other purposes, a very limited use that may never occur. Understand, however, that we're talking about a road that crosses what is now the corporation's property, but ultimately will belong to shareholders in the corporation based on a long-standing plan that the corporation has developed. So when the corporation is asked it'd be a lot easier for us to deal with this problem if the road we're talking about went across the property that ultimately Shaw will get as a shareholder under the plan. He gets all the surrounding land all the way out to 77. I don't think we could put a road in there because it's probably mostly wetlands anyway. The road we're talking about, the road that Maureen and I drove and the fire chief drove, crosses a portion of the corporation's land that ultimately goes to someone else. So the corporation is sensitive. They just can't start granting these rights without at least talking to the other shareholders and say, look, this is going to impact. But if what we're saying is we want to use what's there now, we're not going to do a lot with it, we just want to make it available, we'll improve that stretch that's within our project and agree to keep it open and that sort of thing. I think we could have some success in that regard.
I would just work closely with the public, you know, emergency people, and make sure that what you're doing to bring back before us will get their approval.
Any other comments? Do I hear a motion?
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented in the application of Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision review, wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Ram's Head four-lot subdivision located off Charles E. Jordan Road be tabled to the regular October 1992 meeting of the planning board with the consent of the applicant.
Second.
The applicant consents to that motion.
Thank you, Mr. Cheney. All in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Thank you.
We appreciate your continued willingness to work through these issues.
That Ms. Kane has appeared, but she's not, she's recused herself from the next matter, which is the Gramsci Wetlands Alteration Permit. This is a request by Dr. Reed Gramsci and neighbors for an after-the-fact wetlands alteration permit for installation of underground utilities and an access road in the vicinity of Sunrise Drive and Cunner Lane. The question before the board is application completeness. Dr. Gramsci? Catch us up on what's happened since the last time we met with you.
Okay. What I'd like to do, since I haven't had a chance to do that, is just give you a brief overview of where we stand and how we got here. My name is Reed Gramsci. I'm acting as spokesman for five families in the area of Hanford Cove. We're served by a series of poles that proceed from the end of Hanford Cove Road, in front of our homes, in front of the White House, and ending at the Marshall Monks residence. These lines are antiquated and in need of upgrading. Loss of power and phone services are a regular occurrence due to the exposed nature of the location. Over the past years, the families have considered various options to improve our service and our views. Initial plans were prohibitively expensive and abandoned. However, over the past winter, there was an electrical short and a fire on one of the poles that was inaccessible to the fire department. As a result of this fire, CMP came forward and offered us an affordable solution to our problem. The plan which evolved, is which I think you are hopefully familiar with at this point, is to have three homes, and if you refer to the last exhibit, 2F, I believe it is, in your most recent submission, just to review quickly, three homes will be served by adding one pole down Brook Drive. That's the Smith, Snow, Hanson home, and Gramsci home. This would eliminate the poles that pass in front of the pond along the road. The Fismer home would be supplied by an existing line on Sunrise Drive. This would again require the addition of one pole. Then to be able to get rid of the poles that pass along the ridge in front of the lighthouse in an inaccessible wooded area, the plan is to bury the wires to the Monks Marshall residence, which is on the point. In summary, 14 poles would be eliminated, two poles would be added. To further this project, the five families met with CMP, the phone company, the cable company, and the contractor this spring. CMP felt that the existing Sunrise Drive was too overgrown for them to have access to the required new pole. Therefore, the contractor added 50 cubic yards of gravel to the existing roadbed and the trench was dug. Neither the landowners nor the contractor were aware that the trench passed through an area that had been classified as wetland protection zone. When our electrician applied for permits to reestablish electricity to the individual homes, the trench came to the town's attention and work was stopped. After our July meeting, when I appeared here with our application, five deficiencies were identified in the letter from the town planner. We had 1 week to respond and develop a survey. In spite of intense efforts to find a surveyor that could provide this work, we couldn't do that in the week required. Therefore, it's taken us 2 months to get back here. We now hope our application is complete. And in reference to the town planner's letter of September 15th, I'd just like to add a few points that would hopefully answer some questions. Number I, on the first page of Marino Mero's letter, the CMP, the copies of the easements you have are just copies of the easements. They're not signed nor notarized. The copies of the signed notarized easements are already registered at the Department of Deeds. CMP is able to provide copies of those signed notarized statements. That paperwork was in progress when this application was being completed. And those signed copies of those signed notarized easements will be available in a few days. The engineer's report, there were a couple of questions in the engineer's report that were not addressed in the written application. One was the question of the disposition of the old telephone poles, lines, and transformers. CMP has stated that these are untreated sear poles, the inaccessible poles, those in the wooded area along the ridge that they've had trouble getting to. The plan was to remove any electrical wires, transformers, etc., cut down the poles, they'll be like any other fallen tree. Any poles that were accessible will be removed. I would just conclude by saying that we've done our best to meet the requirements of this board, and we hope that we can move on in all haste to restore this area to its natural beauty.
Thank you, Dr. Ramsey. Since this is a completeness issue, perhaps I'm not sure exactly what the most efficient way is to proceed. Do any board members have any particular comments?
I would just suggest that Maureen go down the list
and check
off what
Why
is
don't
of
you do
issue.
That, please.
Okay. Under, I'll just identify the items where there are waivers or if there's a possibility that they may be incomplete. Under number B, a topographic map is required showing existing and proposed contours. In reviewing the map, I was unsure that existing and proposed contours depicted that the site was going to be returned to its original condition, which is what has been proposed by the applicant. It looked to me like things were going to be leveled out rather than excavated, but I may be incorrect in how I'm reviewing that site plan. I did want the board to note that a waiver was requested for the provision of a wetland vegetation assessment. There is a requirement under item H that the location of standing water be identified. There is standing water in the trench, which has not been identified, but I think board members at the site walk did see that. Finally, there is a waiver requested for the submission of a stormwater runoff plan. The applicant has submitted an erosion control plan, and there is an additional letter from Ross Cutlitz, which the board has received this evening, that talks about the position of silt fencing and the condition of the erosion control plan. Finally, as a result of the site walk that was held by the board the day after the last meeting that this was considered at, there was some concerns expressed about the actual location of property lines and evidence of right title or interest to Sunrise Drive as well as to the individual lots. The applicant has submitted CMP deeds. They're not executed, however. The plans, in addition, don't have meets and bounds descriptions, so it would be a little difficult to determine where the deed runs. And there still is this outstanding question of who owns Sunrise Drive, which a neighbor during the site walk had raised that issue himself. So those are the issues that I guess, my summary of what I think is outstanding.
Any comments by board members?
I would just state that in terms of the topographic plan, I think one has been submitted. If there are questions about clarifications, it would be appropriate to ask for those. But I think that for the nature of this project, the intent of the ordinance in being complete, I think, has been met with what the applicant has submitted. The issue of the deeds, I would be willing to take the applicant's word and proceed with further a review of the applications, assuming that we will receive those deeds. My concern here is I think delaying this project is going to cause more harm to the environment ultimately than waiting for more information from the applicant. The one thing that I am very concerned about, however, having been on the site walk the day after the previous review of the completeness issue, is the fact that there has been earthwork done on an adjacent parcel, and there was a butter there. I believe it was Mrs. Farrington, who was not notified, and there does appear to be some contention as to what is going to happen with the fill that's been placed there, and I don't know that you've addressed that in your application.
That's been addressed in the recent application, and all applicants and the abutter, Mr. and Mrs. Farrington, are satisfied that the road will be restored to its previous level. It says that in the recent application.
I was just going to ask, we don't have anything from Mrs. Farrington, I don't believe, though, and I certainly would like to see that at some point. If that's the ownership in that area, I respect your word, but I would need to see that.
Has there been anything submitted?
There was a statement to that effect, but it wasn't from the abutters.
Yes, I think that's my recollection. Dr. Gramsci, while we're looking for that, I guess I'd like to, I'm the only thing that concerns me at this point is the right title and interest issue. I certainly would be pleased to see the executed copies of the CMP deeds, and I have no questions about that. But what I am concerned about is just how the particular applicants here, the property of those particular applicants relate to each other. And I don't know whether you've asked the surveyor whether it's possible to have him put meets and bounds on the survey and locate the work that we're
I'm not sure we're talking
with.
About the same thing, but the survey that I have has labeled the Leslie Fismer property line, has Hugh Farrington's property line, has the Monk's Trust property line. Is that what you mean?
Yes, that is what I mean.
We also have basically...
But I can't tell from what we're talking about who owns Sunrise Drive.
Okay, Sunrise, the area, this area of Hanford Cove was developed by... this area was developed by Harry Baker starting in the 20s. All the deeds have right of way over all these roads. It appears that the ownership of the roads was retained by Harry Baker. He has long since died, and now that ownership is assumed to be in his heirs. That's the same for Hanford Cove Road, for Cunner Lane, all of the roads in that area.
So the work that has been, part of the work that's already been done, has been done on somebody's property other than the applicants.
We all have right of way to the roads, and therefore that's interpreted as we also have right of way to do anything under the roads as well, in terms of wires and things like that. The problem that was identified...
You have deeded rights of way on that road? On those roads?
The Fismers and the Monks do. Those are the properties that are adjacent. Those are in their deeds. And a copy of that has been submitted, their deeds.
I guess I would appreciate having the surveyor do at least a notation on the survey to reflect who's got rights of way and where those rights of way lie. I don't mean to be asking for a tremendous amount of extra work, but you're asking, it's hard for planning board members to read deeds, and it would be, do you understand what my concern is?
I understand what your concern is, and it's a question that has been raised by other members, other residents of the area, and I think it's a legal dilemma that we have in terms of who owns the road. In essence, we all own the road. We all have right of way over the road. I'm not sure that the surveyor is the one to tell us. The surveyor can tell us where the road is. These roads are all in the town, all in town plans. We know where the roads are, and the problem that has been identified and has been rectified is the fact that the work that was done was not in the proper boundaries of the road. If you look at the survey map, we also know that most of the roads in that area aren't where they're supposed to be. Now, to rectify that, and we feel that the Farringtons had a good point, and we've talked with them, and we're all in agreement that that should be restored.
Okay. Anybody else have any comments?
Is there anyone from Farringtons, representing the Farringtons here tonight?
I believe they're out of town. I talked to them a few days ago.
All I would ask for is a letter saying, yes, his statement is correct and signed. I don't need an affidavit of 2 pages long, but just something that presents the board a clear understanding from the Farringtons that they're in agreement with this plan.
I'd also like to remind the board that if we determine the application is complete tonight, we're required to hold a public hearing, which we would presumably schedule for the October board meeting. Any other comments? Do I hear a motion?
Madam Chair, I'll propose the following motion. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Reed and Patty Gramsey and neighbors for a wetlands alteration permit for underground utilities and construction of an access road in the area of Connor Lane and Sunrise Drive is deemed complete. Be it further ordered that a public hearing is scheduled for the regular October 20th, 1992 meeting of the Planning Board.
Mr. Parkhurst is seconded. Any further discussion?
I do have a question. Has there been any work done in the trench since the site walk? The trench has not been backfilled.
That's correct.
It's clear to me that by the time October 20th rolls around, permanent vegetation cannot be placed on the backfilled material and be expected to survive. The best thing that will happen out of this is that the trench would probably be covered with hay mulch or something and allowed to sit over the winter. Winter rye, even as late as October 20th, might be a little shaky in starting. But I don't see any other way of dealing with it. We're required to have a public hearing, and we are where we are. So it's too bad that the public process can't be more flexible to the real issue on the site, but I don't know that this board has any right to do other than to hold a public hearing and hold up construction until an appropriate time.
Mr. Parker?
So, question for you, Tom. Is it possible to buy, it may sound silly, but can you buy plants that have already been started elsewhere and transplant them so they do have a chance to take hold?
You really won't get effective root growth after this time, and the Soil Conservation Service has dealt with this issue in their review, but once we're beyond about the even late September, we're really into a very difficult growing season. There's no other way that the board can deal with this issue, is there?
Mr. Emmerich, it's funny you should ask. I've just been directed to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board Rules and Regulations effective February the 9th, 1989, which appear to be the latest compilation of the rules. And it says in Section 2B that in addition to regular meetings of the Planning Board that are scheduled, special meetings may be called by the chairman or when requested by a majority of the board. The call for a special meeting shall set forth the matters to be acted on by the board. Now, I'm not intimately familiar with the notice requirements for a public hearing. I guess I would ask the town planner, what is the earliest date on which we could notice a public hearing and adequately advise the interested public of that hearing?
I would suggest that if you gave staff 2 weeks' notice, 2 weeks' time, that we would be able to get notice in the paper and to residents within the week, which is the required time that notices have to be sent out.
So if today is September the 15th, a Tuesday, you're saying that if we cared to, and if a majority of the board agreed, we could notice a special meeting for Tuesday night, September the 29th? Anybody have any discussion on that?
The purpose of that meeting would be for public hearing?
And possible action.
Mr. Emery, would any kind of possible decision on the 29th of September significantly affect the ability of the...
I would have to defer that to the Soil Conservation Service. I can't say categorically that from that date there's so many things that come into it, the weather that occurs after that, but it's certainly better then than it would be in October 20th. There would be no comparison. I guess what I would suggest is the appropriate method is to have the applicant of Marine contact Soil Conservation Service and get a clear recommendation from them as to when the planting season for perennial grasses is cut, because they have definite deadlines in their erosion control recommendations for seeding.
Have you done any investigation of this issue, Dr. Grancy?
From the Ross Cutlets, and basically he addresses the issue of the siltation barrier, and he says, and I quote, time and resources are better spent closing up the site as soon as possible. The germinating season is critically short this time of year. He doesn't make any specific references to time or dates for growing.
Ms. Arden?
I just further ask if that's investigated and the town planner, for instance, finds out that will affect, that I think as one board member I would certainly look to you folks to anticipate approval whether you get that or not and have people set up to immediately do the work so there wouldn't be any question. I mean, that it would happen the next day, for instance.
I've been in almost daily contact with a contractor and I don't think that would be a problem.
I support that as one board member to move it up.
Ms. Parker?
I think we should proceed in a timely fashion.
Do I take it that the sense of the majority of the board is to notice a special meeting for Tuesday, September the 29th?
I think all we need to do is amend the motion.
Mm-hmm.
And special meeting.
I would amend it to say, be it further ordered that a public hearing is scheduled for the September 29th, 1992 special meeting of the Planning Board.
Second is amended.
Further discussion? All in favor? Raise your right hand. Unanimous. Thank you very much, Dr. Grancy.
Thank you.
So could I add one thing?
Yes.
Dr. Gramsci,
could we ask you one thing?
I would just ask that you be in close contact with Maureen and feel that every other issue has been addressed, like the DEP permit by rule, all those things be submitted so she feels confident that we can take final action on it that night.
Yes.
Thank you.
Ms. Kane. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Janet, for serving in for me while I was otherwise
involved in one of my other... Oh, I always thought I could be you. I don't think I could. Our next item of business this evening is Woods Knoll subdivision amendment, request by Robert Barton for an amendment of the previously approved Woods Knoll subdivision located off Old Ocean House Road in accordance with Section 16.2.5 of the subdivision ordinance. Do we have, looks like Mr. Mitchell is going to speak to us.
Excuse me, Madam Chair. Due to a possible conflict, I have to excuse myself from this item.
Thank you, Mr. Parkhurst. Judy Lardner, will you? You run for the evening, I think. Yeah. Would you like to speak?
Okay. My name is John Mitchell, Mitchell & Associates, and I represent Mr. and Mrs. Bob Barton and Mr. and Mrs. John Tuker, co-applicants for this amendment to a previously approved subdivision. Woods Knoll, most of you know, is off of Ocean House Road. It consists of a four-lot subdivision and a single dead-end road with a hammerhead turnaround at the end. It was approved, the subdivision was approved in 1984. Since that time, Bob Barton and his wife have constructed their residence on Lot 2 and presently reside there. And currently, Mr. and Mrs. John Tuker plan to build their house on Lot 4. The request this evening is an amendment or a revision to the property line located on the northern section of Lot 4. Originally it was approved as being in this location straight across. We're requesting a slight modification of that property line. The reason for this is upon further analysis of the lot or the location of where the house is best suited, there are topographical and ledge conditions that if given the required setbacks, the revised property line would work out a lot better for the siting of the individual home. That's the purpose of the request. We've received a letter from T.Y. Lynn. I guess they were asked to visit the site and review the conditions to see if they were in compliance. And they have noted five deficiencies, which I'd like to go over in detail. The first is the granite monumentation. We have checked with the surveyor, and Bob Barton has checked his records. The surveyor was hired to do the granite monumentation right after the construction of the road. For one reason or another, that was not accomplished. The survey has gone out and verified that it wasn't accomplished. But we are prepared to put in the monumentation along the PCs and PTs of the roadway. All of the monumentation for the lots are in. The hemlock screening, number two, which we showed on the original subdivision plan as being a grouping here and a grouping at the end of the road, they are in. They were planted back in 84, and they are all there and surviving. The third item and fourth item are sort of interrelated. The roadway was designed as a gravel drive, or at least it was paved up to station 2+50. From that point on, it was designed as a gravel drive, as indicated on the cross section. The gravel drive and the turnaround was constructed by White Brothers in accordance with the plans. They had this plan. This is a construction document, and the problem is that Bob Barton's house is located here. They're the only house on the subdivision. There has been very little, if any, traffic beyond that point. The weeds have grown up, and essentially it's just it appears to be just a one-lane road, gravel road. But the reason for that is that no one has traveled that road. Again, the applicant is prepared to make all the necessary improvements once Mr. and Mrs. Tugner finish their house on lot 4. The applicant plans to go in and pave the remaining portion of the drive of Woods Knoll Drive. And the last item, number 5, is site distance. There is a site distance condition here. We realize that it was an issue back in 84 when the planning board visited the site. The agreement at that time was that it required a minimal amount of clearing or trimming of vegetation within the state right-of-way. And Bob Barton has done that periodically, and it needs to be done again now, and he is planning on doing that this fall also. That's pretty much the presentation. I'd be glad to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Mitchell. I'll turn it over to the board now. Do we have any comments? Do we have?
I would only suggest that there's no house plan, there's no indication of the required setbacks on the plan we have, but for someone to go through this process and this additional expense, I take it very much at face value that what you're telling us in terms of topography is indeed the case. I don't really have any issue other than.
Maureen, you had something?
I just want to correct some errors that are in the memo that was sent to the board. I also went out to the site again, and it does appear that the hemlock screening is there and that there is a turnaround there, but again, because it hasn't been used and it's not paved, it's kind of hard to really see the full extent of it. The other thing that the applicant has pointed out to me, and I went out and checked again, is that there is a hydrant out there now, so that both the fire chief and I missed it, and I would suggest that we don't need a hydrant out there since there is one there already. So I do want to make that clear. And there was one final, I think, issue raised in terms of the letter of credit. The best I can tell, the letter of credit is gone. It was released. It no longer exists. So this is pretty much a fresh application. But I did want to clarify those issues.
Judy Lardner?
Just have a question, John. You indicated the applicant will be paving the remainder of the road. Is that shown on our plan?
No, it's not.
Why?
I didn't think it had to be shown, to be honest with you. It was designed or approved as a gravel road. I didn't realize that the planning board had to approve.
Would we?
Pavement.
Mr. Mitchell and I had a conversation this afternoon about this, and I told him my only concern was that in the past, the board has tended to review drainage in a slightly different manner if a road was gravel rather than paved. And further, that in talking with the applicant, I didn't think the board would be opposed to having the road paved, but that I thought it should be something that was indicated on the plan.
Because we would have typically the sub base and so forth, right, for our engineering review and see if it's
as far as I'm aware, that's all there.
Right.
The gravel pretty much is all set, and it just needs a little bit of work, and it's ready to go.
But if we're going to have it paved, I'd feel a lot better if the town engineer looks at it and says, yes, the 2 inches of pavement or whatever that is right. Adequate for town standards. And that's what you're proposing is to do.
We will add that to the plan, the final Mylar.
Is that problematic to leave that to the discretion of the town engineer if we said the road shall be paved and plans submitted acceptable to the town engineer?
If you want the road paved according to the subdivision standard, even though this is a private road, that's pretty basic because there are diagrams right in the subdivision ordinance, and there's a specification of exactly how much base paving and then finished paving is required.
Madam Chair.
Stretzel.
I take it that that's only if we make it a requirement of the plan that it is paved. I think the applicant was simply suggesting that they were going to pave it. The plan is that I'm just trying to make sure I've got this straight myself. Is that the plan as it exists indicates that it only need be paved to what was it, station 2+50? It's currently paved past that location now. I think there's an indication on the plan. I don't have it out in front of me. But
it's paved to approximately 4+0.
Could I ask something?
Sure.
On a rhetorical question. If they never told us that they were going to plan to pave the rest of it, and they just paved it, and they were just going to clean it up and get the weeds out of the middle of the turnaround, and then decided to pave it, would they have to come back here? And just like any ordinary people, call up Blue Rock, come out and put some stuff down.
Yeah, that was my...
That's why I'm almost thinking, why are we getting into this? And to me, it doesn't...
I would just question that we have a plan that shows a gravel road and it would be built a certain way.
Well,
and I defer
to
our
planner. Why don't we just leave it a gravel road and let them...
Well, Maureen, do they have to come back? I don't want you to have to come back.
I don't either. I mean, to me, I just...
It just seems to me that if they have every intention of paving it, we might as well just have the plan show what they're proposing to do now.
Yes, I think I agree. I just would like to have the record reflect what the actual intent is, and as long as the applicant doesn't have any problem with complying with the subdivision standards, which I assume you're going to do, then we can take care of it expeditiously.
Okay. I don't want to hold it up for that. That's...
Just a couple more questions or comments.
Okay.
Somewhere it states that the house plans are fairly detailed. Is the house more than a three-bedroom home? Proposed.
The existing
no,
home?
The proposed two-car home.
John?
Is it more than three?
The
four-bedroom. Four-bedroom. Has there been any site evaluation for the septic system to confer with that?
Huh? Yes.
Oh, you just pick up as a note on here that is a requirement, I believe.
Wasn't that a condition of the previous approval that if anything greater than a three-bedroom...
The question dealt with a note that it had to indicate with the proper forms. There was a comment about removing the tennis court from the plan. I look at this note and it looks to be, to me, as a need-not-be-built issue, and I would sort of rather leave it there, and if they decide to put it on there, I'd rather have it there than halfway down toward the parking. I see no need to really remove it.
I agree with that. To me, it just seems, just leave it the way it is.
Right.
It's perfectly clear that it either is going to be built or isn't, and it's at the discretion of the lot owners, as well as the establishment of the parking areas. At that time, I have a question. I'm sorry, Steve. Are you serious?
Yes, I'm all done.
For the life of me, I cannot figure out where Woods Knoll Drive accesses this lot. It seems to touch it, but it doesn't abut it.
Excuse me?
It doesn't abut it. It seems to come close to it. Look up in the corner at the left side.
I think the question is that it goes across the common area.
But doesn't actually get
my, my I read the plan that the entire road is part of the common area.
That's correct.
Is that correct?
Yep.
So that the access... is that your question, Judy? There shows no right-of-way from the existing pavement to the site, and unless you read through this and realize that all of the road is on the common area. It looks like you can't get there from here.
That's all right. Then thank you. That's what I was. I looked through those contours and picked through them, and the 40s and the 20s and the 40.55s, and I didn't see it. Good. As I mentioned, I agree with the. You have the fire hydrant all set. Make sure, I think it would be prudent to make sure that the fire department can find it, seeing as how they didn't the last time they were out there. The letter of credit, do we need to readdress that? Do we want to readdress it?
I don't know that there's any need for it now since there's no fire hydrant.
There's nothing more to do.
There's a list of improvements now. The list is pretty short.
I guess the monumentation, but we can require that it be installed. Maureen, do you have a comment on that?
Well, it depends on how you handle the paving.
If it's according to a plan right now.
Well, this would be considered a minor subdivision, and under the minor subdivision standards, a performance guarantee is at the option of the planning board.
I don't know that we need one.
I don't think so either.
Is this a town road?
No.
It's a private road? How do we know who owns it? There's a common area that's defined on either side of the road, but I don't see any reference to the ownership of the road on the plat.
Note number 7.
Number 7?
The deed, thanks, I think, into, is it to Liz Barton? Elizabeth? Shows a quarter interest in the common area. So I took it to be that it's, I guess it's the deed into the Tookers, had a quarter interest in the common area. So the road is owned proportionately by the lot owners.
Each lot owner has one quarter interest, right, in all of the common area, including private
owners. Is owned in common.
Just to back up to your former question, Judy, your previous question about access to the site, does there not need to be some sort of a right-of-way dedicated or indicated on this plan that Lot 4 has access over the common area into the private road?
You talking to me?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Oh, you said Judy. I thought you were Lardner.
No, I'm sorry.
I didn't remember asking that question.
Person.
I don't know. As soon as you said that,
I could be heard on this, I think it's an issue that can be solved in the deeds very easily and does not necessarily need to have a reflection on the plans. I guess for my purposes, though, Mr. Mitchell, I would appreciate it if we could mark in block letters on the tennis court and the gazebo need not be built in addition to putting the note 8 on the notes themselves, just to really clarify the situation.
John, I'll just raise one other question. Under the town's ordinances, tennis courts are conditional use. Swimming pools and tennis courts fall under a conditional use, and the setbacks are, if there's any variance required from a setback other than that for structure. Has this been located as a structure?